And then we also have in the studio Goylo Golez. He's a former national security advisor. Gentlemen, thanks for joining us this morning.
Thank you so
There's
much.
A lot to get through. Let me begin with the crisis in the Middle East. We're talking about air, sea, and land transport links to Qatar having been cut off. We're already getting reports of panic buying on the ground. Goylo, you're a former national security advisor. Just how vulnerable are the 200,000 or so OWCs?
Well, we have 250,000 OWCs in Qatar. The biggest source of danger there is a food blockade. I understand that there are many trucks already because there's only one land border between Qatar and the sources of food, and that's Saudi Arabia, which is the one leading the diplomatic war against Qatar. And their other points of entry would be by sea. But on the other hand, I understand that most of the ships that go to Qatar will have to pass through the United Arab Emirates also, which is part of the diplomatic coalition set up by Saudi Arabia. So there's a question of whether the ships can also be blockaded, but most of the sources will be by land from Saudi Arabia. So there's a big concern on food security. Not to mention that we are talking of a country with 2.6 million people, about 250,000 are Filipinos, and about 2.1 million are foreigners, and the rest are from Qatar. So there might be a need for a massive air shipment, but I think it is going to be very difficult.
Well, having said that, what kind of response do you want to see from the government, whether it be the DFA or the Labor Department? We already know that they've stopped deployments to Qatar.
Well, they have their SOPs. I think they're now running an inventory of what people there, finding out their status, especially their food status, and then coordinating with the government to find out how's the food security situation, because when it becomes very acute, there's a real possibility even of food riots inside Qatar once the food runs out. That's going to be a big challenge. But I'm hoping that there will be some mediators. I understand that Kuwait is trying to mediate the diplomatic problem right now. Of course, the U.S. is there also. The U.S. is an air base in Qatar, and they have a very good relationship with Saudi Arabia, with UAE, and the other countries involved, including Egypt, Libya, and the other countries that are part of this diplomatic coalition against Qatar.
Malcolm, let me turn to you now. Look, it's not the first time that Qatar has been embroiled in diplomatic, has been sanctioned, so to speak. Back in 2014, a number of Gulf nations also pulled out their diplomats from Doha, although that issue was fairly resolved fairly fast. Are you getting the sense this time around that it's a lot more serious?
Well, certainly, as we noted, seven countries have basically blockaded it. And it's interesting that this happened so quickly after Donald Trump's first trip to the region. And so I think the American factor, which is key in the Middle East, helped shape how the Gulf countries deal with each other, certainly in play here. So this is the biggest crisis Doha, and for that matter, that Gulf Cooperation Council has faced in decades, and it came very quickly and as a surprise almost to everybody as well.
Even as that crisis plays out over in the Middle East, there are ongoing conflict at home here in the Philippines as well. Let me move on now to the Marawi crisis. Right? President Duterte has largely been heavy-handed about his approach to the insurgency down south. And he says, just yesterday, I'm ordering you to crush them. You have to destroy everything, including lives. Malcolm, let me ask you first, what did you make of that?
I think it's part of a pattern with President Duterte since he was running for office, this idea that if you put more force and violence into a situation, that will lead to a solution. He's also mentioned the fact that there's links between the war on drugs and terrorism in the Morawi City incident. So I think when you can see that martial law may last longer than 60 days and even spread. So I think we're at the beginning of a much bigger problem.
Was that the right approach, do you think, Goylo, as former national security advisor?
Well, I'm listening to the military, the Department of National Defense, the armed forces, and they're giving themselves something like 3 days, that was about 2 days ago, to be able to solve this problem, but not really solve it 100%. The martial law period is 60 days, we're into about 2 weeks only. So my point there is, let's give them some space, don't pressure them. we're talking of a situation of just rather new as far as the military is concerned. But I think it's quite manageable. I have supported the declaration of martial law. I think it's necessary. Some people are asking why the whole of Mindanao. Well, we're dealing here with a very mobile group that could spring from one area to another. So it's better that the armed forces set up together with the PNP, set up some blocking forces and checkpoints all over Mindanao, including assistance to the local government.
Malcolm, so Rolo here in the studio with me thinks that martial law was the right response to this crisis in Mindanao. Let me ask you straight up, do you think that's also the right response?
I think martial law maybe in Manao del Sur was good, but all of Mindanao, that's quarter of the population in the largest island in the country. And as I said, President Duterte has already hinted more than once about expanding it to the zone and decides even before declaring it on May 23rd. So that's my worry, that this will spread both in terms of time and in terms of geography from the serious problem in Marawi City to other issues, including the war on drugs, which he has already made links to and as a potential justification for longer and broader martial.
Isn't that a valid concern, Royal?
I'm not in favor of expanding it outside Mindanao. I'm also not in favor of extending it beyond 60 days, because if we extend it, if the government extends beyond 60 days, that means that it's having a problem controlling the situation, especially more so if it would expand. And I think that the president, the government, must conclude this as quickly as possible. The faster, the better. And it will look good as far as the government will look good, the president will look good, if this is resolved as quickly as possible, way within 60 days.
Does it matter at all that we've been getting conflicting statements about the presence of ISIS in the Philippines? The AFP and the military at the start were very insistent that there's not, this is the handiwork of the OTE and not ISIS, but the president directly contradicted them on it. Does it matter at all?
Well, ISIS is partly responsible for that news. They keep on claiming everything. Like, you remember, they claimed the resort port incident, which proves that they're just propagandizing. On the other hand, the Mahuti group is also trying to use this for propaganda. They're trying to glamorize themselves by trying to link with the ISIS in order to be able to perhaps attract more attention, to be able to recruit those that are attracted by the spectrum of ISIS. So right now, I think the government was fine-tuned their intelligence. They got some feedback from the Indonesian government. The two intelligence groups have been exchanging information to find out how deep is the ISIS connection, if at all there is that deep ISIS connection. I'm just a little careful about this.
Well, what about you, Malcolm, as someone who was looking at this from the outside? What did you make of the conflicting statements?
I think Mr. Gulez is right that ISIS is both a organization and kind of a brand name that other groups attach themselves to. But if the reports are true that there were a number of foreign fighters from other Southeast Asian countries killed in the Marawi City siege, then that would add evidence that at least there's growing links between the Mauke group, the relatively new ones, Abu Sayyaf, being around for a while, regional terrorists, and ISIS. So I think if that's true, then the link starts to look more credible.
What kind of a response, or maybe the better question is, what kind of responsibility does ASEAN have in light of growing concerns over terrorism?
Certainly, again, there we can see from statements from the Singapore Defense Minister, and as mentioned, the talk between Jakarta and Manila, that this is now seen to be a regional problem. And over the last 10 years, intelligence sharing and police cooperation through ASEAN has grown significantly to deal with this terrorism bump. So I think the region has done well in the last 10 years to work with each other on this common problem, and we're seeing this start to play out again in Marawi, with the Marawi City incident.
And finally, Royal, I wanted to talk to you about the resort's world attack. What did you make of the response to it?
Well, there were some lapses, definitely. If the security was not breached by the gunman, then we don't have this trouble. The other, well, that's why I think now there's a congressional investigation going on. I hope they will look at the security SOP of not only Resort World, but the other similar establishments. Also, the role of the Bureau of Bioprotection, the Philippine National Police. There was this announcement by the PNP that there was only one fatality. And then after about 1 hour, only to find out that there was quite a lot of bodies all over there.
Is that normal in a crisis situation?
No, I think the normal thing would be for them to sweep the entire area, a security sweep, to find out whether there's some other casualty there, whether there's some other gunmen who may be involved, before saying that it's all over. You know, that's SOP in something like this. The other thing is, of course, making announcements. You know, media is part of this, government's part of this. Stick to facts in order not to fan the speculation, because during that time there was so much speculation, ISIS came into the picture also.
Well, we tried to stick to the facts as best as we could here in Bloomberg, but even so, you're absolutely right. We ourselves are getting conflicting reports. I mean, it wasn't until a little after 10:30 that morning.
That's the template in crisis management. To stick to the facts. Do not encourage people to speculate.
On that note, we have to leave this conversation there. Thanks very much for your time.
Thank you so much.
Roland Rollins, former National Security Advisor, and over in Singapore, Malcolm Cook, Senior Fellow at the ICES Yusuf Ishak Institute in Singapore. Thanks for your time today. We're going to pause for another short one right after this. An IT group comes up with a calculator that computes not only your new income taxes, but also the higher cost of products under the proposed tax reform package.
Corporate, so much.